נעשה את בבא מציע, פייג' 54, we'll start on page 53b, 16 lines from the bottom of the page. The subject of מטבע חסרה, the subject of a currency that doesn't carry the full value of the currency, is the subject that occupied us in the past several dapim. We try to say that as far as the Maaser Sheni, as far as the second tithe, we can use it, even if it's carrying less than its value. In general, we know that Maaser Lo Zorkim, when it's come to the tithes, the Maaser carry Kedusha. But today we're going to deal with the subject of Milabar and Milagav, meaning when the Torah referred to us by saying Ve'asav Chamishito Alav, when it's come to evaluation of tithe, there is an 1/5 additional. The question is, when you have, for example, the principal, the keren, it's 20, and the chomesh, the 1/4, again, 1/4, you count the 4 because the way you go by the 20, but soon you see the source that is going by 1/5, which in general that's the result of 1/5, the calculation of 1/5, the calculation of the 20%, and that's the idea of when we need to redeem Maaser Sheni. Mishnah referred to us, soon you see in the tractate Elkin, but let's first see the subject we left again, page 53b, 16 lines from the bottom of the page, Tanu Rabanan. The Torah tells us in the book of Vayikra, chapter 27, Im ga'ol yig'al ish mi ma'aso. If a man will redeem of his tithe, he shall add to it 1/5 part thereof. So, in order to use Maaser Sheni, we cannot redeem. From where do we derive that important halakha? We derive it from this pasuk, in this verse, meaning, lo, you cannot go by the entire Maaser Sheni in order to eat it. You cannot just go and eat it. You can have the option to ligol velivdo, to redeem, and by the emphasis, they use the word mima asro, because the pasuk, the verse, use the word mima asro on his tithe, but not all of his tithe, which means miktzat, its part, and not the entire tithe. Prat lemaaser sheni she'en bo shve pruta. Here we have the exclusion. Exclusion is that when you have a Maaser Sheni, a second tithe, that does not have the value of one pruta, so you cannot redeem it. Now, if someone uses a pruta, the tfisat kedusha, the carry of the second is not cannot carry it, because as we said, it's a one pruta is the requirement. Itma. Rabbi Ami en amar en bo, Rabbi Asi amar en bechunsho. So, first what we understand. We understand by Rashi, it tells us that if the matbea, the currency, doesn't carry the value of pruta, we cannot redeem it because it's not considering a matbea. There is a machloket, you see it, the Tosfot Rosh and the Ravid versus Rashi. What happened when one wants to eat it outside of Yerushalayim? But anyway, here the Braita tells us that Rabbi Ami hold that the second tithe cannot be redeemed in a case where the produce itself does not have the value of one pruta, cannot have the Maaser Sheni. Rabbi Asi amar en ber חומשו, ואז נעשה the second taken על יהודים in a case where its additional payment of one-fifth does not have the value of one-pluta. That's the idea of the Milebal, that the one-fifth has to carry the pluta, which means that the Maaser has to have the value of at least four plutot. That's the Rashi expressed with this emphasis in the text. But the Gemara here bring other Amoraim that dispute the same issue. Rabbi Yochanan amar, en bo, Rabbi Shimon ben Lakish amar, en bechumsho. Rabbi Yochanan says the produce itself does not have the value of one pultar. Rish Lakish said its additional payment of one fifth does not have the value of one pruta. Maybe we learn the brighter. Maaser sheni she'en bo shaveh pruta, dayo shomar hu bechumsho mechulal al ma'od rishon. Here is the emphasis on the word dayo. You have the second type produce that does not have the value of one pruta. So it is sufficient, dayo, that he will say hu vechumsho, it and its additional payment of one-fifth are desacralized upon the first coin upon which are already redeemed second type produce. So here you see the emphasis on the yo, and the Rashi explained to us that that applies, Chizkiah teaches, over previous Chilul Maaser Sheni, that's the using of those coins, those Maasrot. He said, Ein Bechumsho, Haim Diktane Dayo. Bishlam Adaman Damar Ein Bechumsho, if we follow the one that said that, that there is no value of one puta, it's additional payment of one fee. So that's the reason why the Tana teach is sufficient. It's sufficient, which means that's the Chiddush that give him comes in him the idea that he can redeem on the original Ma'ot Rishon, original money. Afal gav bedidei itbei, even though in the produce itself it has the value of one pruta, kevan de bechumshei leka, since there is not the value of one of a pruta in its one-fifth payment, it works out well, shapir, because it's sufficient if he redeems the produce without a second type produce. Ela leman de amar ein bo mai dayo, but according to the one who says that it is in a case where the produce itself does not have the value of one pruta, that the second type cannot be redeemed. What does that mean when you use the word dayo, it's sufficient? Because as we see, there was never sufficient value for there to be any element of redemption. So the Gemara left it kasha, it's difficult to explain this view. So it means en baze chidush, it's not a chidush. Exclude what already we learn, what Chizkiah teaches us. Now, the Gemara here have a chakira. You need to understand what does that mean when you use chomesh, when you use one-fifth. Ibayelu chomsha milgav o chomsha millebar. The predicament, the dilemma here is the payment of one-fifth calculated from within, which is one-fifth of the value of the redeemed item, or from without, meaning one-quarter of the value of the redeemed item, which is one-fifth of the eventual payment, which is the principal plus an additional one-fifth. Meaning, simply speaking, if you have 20 and you need to bring 4 or 5, so after you will give 25, right? So what is that exactly, the homage, the one-fifth? It's from the 20 or the 25, which means kach erech maaser sheni, you take the second tithe, divide it to 5, or each fifth you add, and then that's the way you have it together. So you see here the divided the principle plus the Tosefet Chomesh. Amar Avina Tashma. Avina said, come and see a very important Mishnah. The Mishnah is in Tractate Erekin, page 26. The Mishnah speaks, obviously, the era of the Bayit Sheni, of the Second Temple, when someone redeemed a field that was sanctified. So, Adam Ikdish Sadeh, a fellow sanctified his field, and obviously it has to be in the time that Yovel Onoheg, in the time that the Jubilee is not applied. Why? Because if one Makdish Sadeh Ubayovel, if one sanctified his field during the Jubilee year, the Torah gives a very clear explanation how Schumim Ketuvim, how exactly one should redeem it. Since not local Israel at Matam, not the entire nation, Israel is dwelling in the place, and you don't have the Yovel. However, at the time of Beit HaMikdash, so they apply the Yovel, so it has to be in Bayit Sheni. Now a fellow, Hikdish Shadeh, he sanctified his field, and now he wants to redeem it. So how you handle this if you don't have a Yovel? So the Balabai, the owner, offer, let's say 20. So he needs to give a Chomesh. The Chomesh, it's, if you go by the Mishnah in Elkin, you see that it's from Milebar, from outset. And the reason, if you see clearly the way that it's going in Mishnah, it's calculated from without Milebar. So let's say two people compete, one's giving 20, and they said, okay, you sell to this, how you handle it? The one offered 20, one offered 21. So if it's the Balabai, the one who owns it, he needs to add 5. It means that when it's come to Maasrot, he can be in the principal less than the owner. You do 21 plus 5, it's 26. In the language of the Mishnah in Erekin, let's see. הבעלים אומרים ב-20 וכל אדם ב-20. הבעלים קודמים מפני שמוסיפים חומש. If the owner says he is willing to redeem consecrated property for 20 dinars, and any other person willing to purchase the property for 20 dinars, the owner take precedence and redeem the property due to the fact that they are obligated to add chomesh, to add 1/5. And the temple treasury profits more from the owner than from anyone else. So basically on the Mishnah in Elkin, you see that it's 5. 5 milabar, not milagav. Amar le'echad, arei alai b'21. Another case, if one who was not the owner said, it is incumbent upon me to desecralize it for 21 dinars. So we turn to page 54, but for 1 second, let's just read the Rashi, the 53b. חומשה מלגב על שווה 20 זוז מוסיף 4, שהן חומשו של קרן. So Rashi said it clearly. If it's milgav, if it's 20, he add 4, that's 1/5 of the principal. או חומשה מלבר, 4 lines from the bottom, על 4 רבעים מוסיף החמישית מן החוץ דבר ל-20 זוז, 5 זוזים. So here Rashi make it very clear that if it's 20 and it's milebar, so without, so it's another 5. 54. הבעלים נותנים 26. So the owner give payment of 26 dinar. So why? Because we don't want the Hekdesh to lose money. The concept is that when the other person he needs to purchase it for 21 dinar, the temple treasury will incur a loss, as the principal plus one-fifth paid the owner by the owner is greater than the payment with the other person. One must pay only the principal. Were the owner to pay only 20 for the principal and add one-fifth, the principal paid by the owner is less than sum offered by the other person. So as a result, the owner pays the principal proposed by the other person and then adds the payment of one-fifth that he was obligated to pay based on his own effort, which is 5 dinars, for a total of 26. That's what we said, 21 plus 5 is 26. Likewise, here is the enumeration of all the other situation, which is 22. If the other person offers 22 dinars, הבעלים נותנים 27, the owner gives 27. Again, that's the whole חומש. ב-23, הבעלים נותנים 28, it's 23, the owner need to give 28. ב-24, הבעלים נותנים 29. If it's 24, the other person offers 24, so the owner gives 29. What you see here, שמע מינה. You see here, 25, הבעלים נותנים 30. לפי שהם מוסיפים חומש על עילוי של זה, שמע מינה, חומש המלבר, שמע מינה. So, as Rashi here beautifully put it together, and Rashi said, שמע מינה, חומש המלבר מדקטני, חומש על 20 סלעים, ממש סלעים, הרי חומש מלחוץ. So, that's without. שמע מינה, twice, that's the final. That's the way we should learn from the Mishnah. Now, in the Parshat בחוקותיי, Book of Vayikra, Parshat בחוקותיי, the Torah said, "Ve'asav chamishito alav." Meaning, you need to add one-fifth. If someone bring an animal, so if he sanctify it, so they have the principle, but he said, "Need to add chamishit, one-fifth." So here you see a disputation of Tanaim. You have. Again, behemat me'ah, an animal that was not befitting, that someone sanctified for temple maintenance. So the Torah said in Parashat Bechukotai Vayikra, chapter 27, verse 27, Ve'yasaf chamishito alav. He shall add unto it one-fifth part thereof. Meaning, she'yehu v'chumsho חמישה דברי רבי יושיע. So רבי יושיע holds that the term and its additional one-fifth payment will total five parts. One-fifth is calculated from without. That's רבי יושיע. רבי יונתן אומר חמישיתו חומשו של קרן. Here רבי יונתן holds that it's one-fifth means one-fifth of the principal. One-fifth is calculated from within. So now the Gemara dealing with situation that you have a Maaser Sheni, a second tithe, that one redeem without adding one-fifth. Ibai lehu chomesh me'akev or eno me'akev. So Rashi here tells us, achila chutz lachoma sheiten lachomesh. Which means, there's failure to pay an additional one-fifth payment consumption outside of Yerushalayim of second tithe that was redeemed or that does not prevent consumption. Now the Gemara elaborates on this dilemma. Arba'a be'arba'a parik ve'akanafshe, which is second tithe produce worth 4 dinars, redeemed with 4 dinars, and the obligation to add the payment of one-fifth is an obligation incumbent upon the owner itself. And Rashi tells us, Akanafshei me'eila ve'ino b'chal ha'pidyon sh'abazuzin padu ma'aser shu ken negdam. O dilma mosif chomesh, alma chomesh lo me'akev, o dilma ba'arba'a ba'chamisha parik וחומש מעכב. Or you can say that the other way around, that one second time produce worth 4 dinar is redeemed with 5 dinar, no less, and failure to pay the additional 1/5 prevents consumption. That's why Rashi said, "Hikach u'gzirat ha-katuv, she'achomesh min ha-pidyon hi, ve'en shove 4 nigdim pachot me-5." So, Rashi make it very clear. So now the Gemara bring a Mishnah in order to explain this predicament. Amar Ravina Tashma. Ravina said, come and hear a proof from a Mishnah, Tractate Amai, chapter 1, Mishnah number 2. Hadmai. Hadmai, this is something we learned in several places. It's the something that we doubt, the Ama Aretz, someone who's not educated, and for sure it's a different Ama Aretz in those days than nowadays. But in those days, the sages required to take a tithe of a produce that were purchased from Ama Aretz. So if you have a second tithe of, doubtedly, because we are in a doubt with the Ama Aretz, if they tithed or not, so the rabbinic law requires to do a special tithe for that. However, ein lo chomesh ve'ein lo bi'ur. There is no payment of 1/5 if the owner redeems it second tithe. And also, there is no obligation of the getting rid, eradication of the tithe after 3 years, as is in the case with tithes taken from untithed produce. Ha-keren yeshlo. So here Ravina explains, but the payment of principle, there is payment of principle. Even we have no obligation to add 1/5, second tithe separated from Dmai require redemption. My ta'ama, what's the reason that the sages divided between keren and chomesh, between the principal and the additional 1/5? Keren din akev bideoraita, ita biderabanan. When it's come to the principal, so if one failure to pay, so that prevents consumption of second tithe of untithed produce by Torah law. Now, it's also a sum that must be paid in a case of demai by rabbinic law. However, chomesh delo me'akev bideoraita, but when it comes to payment of 1/5, that which failure to pay does not prevent consumption of second tithe of untithed produce by Torah law, leita biderabanan. It is not a sum that must be paid in the case of demai by rabbinic law. So the Gemara claimed that apparently there is a Tanaic disputation over that. Leima ketanai. You may say that this is a disputation among the Tanaim in the following braita. Natan et ha-keren ve'lo natan et ha-chomesh. Here you have a situation that one gave payment to redeem the principal but did not give payment of the additional 1/5. Rabbi Eliezer omer yochal, Rabbi Yoshua omer lo yochal. Rabbi Eliezer said that one allowed to eat them those produce outside of Yerushalayim. Rabbi Yoshua said no, shouldn't eat it outside of Yerushalayim. Amar Rabbi, so Rabbi Yehuda Nasi said, nir'in divrei Rabbi Eliezer b'Shabbat ודברי רבי יהושע בחול. So apparently the statement of Rabbi Eliezer is correct when it's come to Shabbat. When it's come to Shabbat, the sages redeemed permitted for one to eat without additional payment, because in deference of Shabbat, that's Kvoda Shabbat, when it's come to regular day of the week. So Rabbi Yeshua view is apparently correct. Why? Because during the week, those produce are prohibited from eating until he pay the one feed. So Rashi in Tosfot explained, Rabbi hold that the prohibition against eating the perot without giving one fifth is rabbinic. Why? Because there is a concern that the person may do a pshia, meaning intentionally will not give the one fifth. So that decree applies to week and not on Shabbat, in order to avoid the mitzvah of oneg Shabbat. So now the Gemara bring a diyuk from the word of Rabbi Yehuda Hanasi, mi de amar nir in divrei Rabbi Eliezer b'Shabbat. From the fact that Rabbi Yehuda Hanasi says that the statement of Rabbi Eliezer appears correct with regard to Shabbat, versus during the week he is not agree with Rabbi Eliezer, michlal difligei afilu b'chol. So it means that disagree even with regard to the days of the week. So Rashi explained that here we talk about clearly tight, not demai, doubted tight. Mide amar nir'in divrei Rabbi Yehoshua b'chol, michlal defligei afilu b'shabbat. Because we said that apparent word of Rabbi Yehoshua applied to the week, it understood that the disputation, disagree, is also with regard to Shabbat. So you see a very fundamental dispute. Mar said, my love beha svara kamifligei. Is it not the disputed with and come to the following reasoning? The Rabbi Yezer savar chomesh lo meakev. The Rabbi Yehoshua savar chomesh meakev. The Rabbi Yezer holds that failure to pay the additional of one fee does not prevent consumption as redemption of the principal alone suffices. Rabbi Yehoshua holds that failure to pay the additional one-fifth prevents consumption. So Gemara rejected Amar Rav Papa, no, you cannot go with that explanation of the disputation. And the following is the explanation. Bechule alma chomesh lo me'akev. Everyone agrees that additional one-fifth does not prevent consumption. Meaning one who eats outside of Yerushalayim, second tithe that he redeemed without giving the one fifth, not receive the malkot, because the statement was made in Devarim chapter 12 is Lo tuchal lechol bisharecha maasar deganecha v'hacha bechayshina lifshiuta kami palgei. Here we are concerned about potential negligence, meaning that he have a sechadah, that is not pay attention that he has the obligation to give one-fifth. Ma savar Rabbi Yehoshua hol chayshina lipshiuta. Rabbi Yehoshua hol that we are concerned for negligence. Lest one failed to pay the additional one-fifth, and as a result the owner may not eat the second type produce until he adds one-fifth payment. Ma savar Rabbi Eliezer hold, lo chayshina lifshiuta. We're not concerned for negligence, and one will presumably add the one-fifth payment later. So therefore, lechatchila, according to Rabbi Eliezer, you're allowed to eat. So now the Gemara wants to emphasize that the disputation between Rabbi Eliezer and Yeshua is not in regards to hekdesh. Amar b'yochanan akol modim behekdesh shechilel ho'il ve'gizbarim tov'in oto bashuk. Even though the Tanaim disagree when it's come to the second tithe, everyone agree when it's come to concentrated property that if the one who consecrated it paid the principal and not paid one-fifth, that he successfully desacralized the produce, since the temple treasurer demand payment for him in the marketplace, meaning the value of the marketplace, as the Torah said in Vayikra chapter 27, that that is additional one-fifth one needs to add to redemption of an item. And the big question is, what does that mean, bashuk? The Rashash said that that applies to a treasurer, not just a regular person to come after his fellow for to pay. But the idea is that the value is the marketplace, preventing any potential negligence, and as a result, he may use the property immediately. So the Gemara now challenged the view of Rabbi Yochanan, and the Gemara said, "Behekdesh lo plige." When it's come to a consecrated property, we did not disagree. "Behatanya natan et hakeren velo natan et hachomesh." Have a situation here that the owner gave payment to redeem the principal, but not the additional one-fifth payment. Rabbi Eliezer omer chilel. Rabbi Eliezer said, you know what? He did the chilul, desacralized successfully. It's fine. Because that desacralization of the item, it's in effect, and therefore even by the rabbinic law it's okay. Bachachamim umrim lo chilel. However, the sages said he did not desacralize the produce, meaning it's still asubana, it's still prohibited by rabbinic enactment to drive any benefit until it gives the one-fifth. You see more the Rambam in the Hilchot Erkin, chapter 7. Amar Rabbi nir'im devri Rabbi Eliezer be'ekdesh ve'divrei chachamim b'ma'aser. So he said that the view of Rabbi Eliezer when it's come to consecrated property, it appeared correct, meaning we are not concerned about negligence and not giving the one-fifth, since the treasurer of the Hekdesh will go after him. But when it's come to the tithe, the second tithe, the view of the sages appear the correct one, since it's prohibited to eat outside of Yerushalayim by the rabbinic enactment until you put the one-fifth for the concern of negligence and not giving it. So now the Gemara bring a diuk inference from the view of Rabbi that the disputation for both, for the tithe and the consecrated item. Mide amar, from the fact that Rabbi Yehuda Hanasi said, nir'im divrei Rabbi Eliezer behekdesh, that the statement of Rabbi Eliezer appeared correct when it's come to a consecrated property, we derive from here, bichlal de palig afilu b'maaser. It means that Rabbi Eliezer disagree even with regard to the second tithe. Medekamar nir'im divrei chachamim b'maaser. When he said that the view of the sages appear correct when it's come to the tithe, michlal de in hu plige afilu behekdesh. We derive from here that they disputed, disagree even with regard to consecrated property. So that basically a total contradiction of Rabbi Yochanan's statement that there is no dispute when it's come to a consecrated property. So here the Gemara rectified the view of Rabbi Yochanan. Ela I itmar, if you say that according to Rabbi Yochanan, everyone agrees when the consecrated property, hachei itmar, that's the way we should state it. Amar Rabbi Yochanan, hakol mudim b'shabbat b'ekdesh shechilel. Everyone agrees when it's come to Shabbat, when it's a consecrated property, that he successfully desacralized the property. Chada dichtiv v'karata la Shabbat oneg ve'od hoil v'gizbarim tovim oto bashuk. There are 2 points. Number one, because it's written in Isaiah 58, and you shall call Shabbat a delight, that basically facilitates that delight in Shabbat by ruling leniency. And moreover, it is desacralized without payment of additional one-fifth, since the temple treasurers demand payment from him in the marketplace. So we're not concerned that he will not pay it. The Ritva Ed, and he said that it only applies to consecrated on Shabbat. Amar Rabbi Chama. Now the Gemara searched that those principles apply only to the principal, or it's apply also to the Chomesh, the one-fifth. Three dinim. Amar Rabbi Bar Chama. הרי אמרו, that's Gemara in Bechorot, page 51, הקדש אינו מתחלל על הקרקע, לרחמנה אמר, ונתן הכסף וקם לו, חומשו מהו שהתחלל על הקרקע. Here they said, Rabbi Bar Chama says it. Our sages did not, they said when it's come to a consecrated property, it cannot be desacralized with land, because we said in the book of Leviticus, chapter 27, they said that when it's come to redemption of a consecrated field, now the quote of the Pasuk said, and he will give the money and it will be a shoot to him, which means that the redemption is accomplished with money. Now, he asked a question, what is the halacha when it's come to the possibility of the one-fifth? What is the, that it will be desacralized with land? Now it's important to note that there's no place in the Torah you have this verse. Rashi emphasized him and he said, I bring the Pasuk in Vayikra 27, ויסף חמישית כסף עליו, ערכך עליו, והיה לו. Now, Tosfot in Tractate Shabbat, page 128, explained to us that even we know that there's no precise verse that that say in this word that the Gemara mentioned, Benatana Kesev Kaflo, but it's a reference to the other verse that Rashi mentioned. But the Tosfot hold that the sages on occasion cite a verse in a bridge form or with a slightly altered formulation in order to underscore the main point of the verse according to their view. So the question is, how is the halacha that one cannot utilize land to redeem consecrated property derived from the verse? Although the verse mentions money alone, the halacha is that one may utilize movable property as well to redeem a consecrated property, and perhaps the same is in the case with regard to land. The answer is derived by means of hermeneutic principle of klal upart uklal, of a generalization, a detail in generalization, from which one derived that the redemption may be accomplished with money and all items similar to a movable property, but not with land, document, or servants, which are not similar to money. That's the Rosh and the Ritva. But the question is, as we said, what do you do with the additional one-fifth? One is saying, what's the halacha when it's come to the possibility that it will be desecralized with land? Second din, if you have a zav, a non-priest, unintentionally, truma, a truma, אינה משתלמת אלא מן החולין. His debt cannot be repaid by to the Kohen only with a non-sacred property, not with truma, not with money. The רחמנה אמר, because the Torah said in Vayikra, chapter 22, ונתן לכהן את הקודש, and he shall give that which is sacred to a Kohen, דבר הראוי להיות קודש, which is the non-sacred item, not truma, which cannot be consecrated again. So the question is, what about the one-fifth? What is the halacha in terms of the possibility that it will be repaid not from the non-sacred item but from truma. The third din, ma'aser ein mitchalel al ha'asimon. When it's come to a second tithe, produce cannot be desacralized with a unminted coin. Money that you don't have a tsuwa, you don't have a minted, you don't have a phase or other description of typical coin. The Rachamana Amar, because it was said in the book of Dvarim, chapter 14, וצרתה הכסף בידיך, and you should bind up the money in your hand, which the sages interpret as serving to include לרבות כל דבר שיש עליו צורה, to include any item that has the imprint of a coin upon it for desacralization, not an unminted coin. So the question is, with regard to payment of its additional one-fifth, חומשו מהו שיתחלל על האסימון, what is the הלכה in terms of the possibility that it will be decircularized with an unminted coin? So the Gemara explain, התגלגל מלטה ומטה לקמי דרבה. Rabbi Bar Chama was unable to resolve this, and the matter proceeded and came before the Rabbah, who said to the people who related the dilemma to him, Amar lehu amar kra, he said to them, the verse said in Leviticus chapter 27, Alav, and it shall add unto it one-fifth part, lerabot chumsho kimoto, which serves to include its additional one-fifth within the same legal status as that of its principal. A proof to that from the Mishnah, in Tractate Trumot, chapter 6, Amar Ravina af anan namitanina. Ravina said, we too learn from this Mishnah. Hagonev truma velo achala. So, the Rashash, the Rashi here, speaks about one who steal Chuma but not partake of it. The Chozer Be'ein. So, Meshalem Tashlumei Kefel. He is a typical Ganav, it's a typical thing. You need to pay a double payment, the principal and as the price of the Chuma. And we know that the thief needs to pay double value of the item that he stole. So the way we calculated those items, it's based on the price of the truma, which is lower than the price of a non-sacred food, as the demand for it is lower because it's eaten only by the kohanim. Dmei truma, so it means he paid his fine. Dmei truma. If the thief ate unintentionally, he paid the payment worth the value of two principals, and he adds one-fifth in a manner, achala, he paid one principal and one-fifth from the sacred, like any non-Kohen who partakes the truma. Achala meshalem shnei kranim v'chomesh, קרן וחומש מן החולים, והקרן דמי תרומה. And when it's come to other principle, he paid it according to the price of the תרומה, meaning the value of the תרומה that can sell in the market. Page 54b, שמה מינה חומשו כמותו שמה מינה. So we derive from here that the legal status of חומש, of one-fifth payment, is the same as the principle in itself, which means it must be paid from a non-sacred property. And that's basically Re'ayah L'Divrei Rava. The late Rabbi Yechiel Michal Tukochinsky, the author of Gesher HaChaim and many more, great rabbi in Yerushalayim, he brings on this sugya Tosfot in Tractate Eruvin, the discussion that he had in one of his young, relatively students, was the later one, the great Rav Shlomo Zalman Auerbach. The question is, how you treated coins? Tosfot in Eruvin said that Matbea Me'etz, in those days, they made certain coin, which is hard for us to see how, because we get used to gold, silver, copper, but they made out of some type of wood. So Tosfot hold in Eruvin that is not lo nechshav matbea, it's not considering it a coin for Ma'atzer Sheni. The Torah said clearly, v'tzalta ha-kesef beyadecha. Kesef, Rabbi Chil Michal Tukuchinsky explained to Rabbi Shlomo Zalman Auerbach Zatzal, he said, kesef, it's kesef dafka, lo bechomer acher, not in something else that is made. But the dialogue between the two, you can read in the writing of Rabbi Chil Michal Tukuchinsky, obviously not Gesher HaChaim, and others, that discussion based on our sugya. Now the Gemara asks another question when it's come to Chomesh. The question is when it's come to Hekdesh. So the Hekdesh, do we have the payment of 1/5 Chomesh ala Chomesh? Why? Because here is the Pasuk. If you have a gazlan, a robber, the Torah said in the book of Vayikra, chapter 5, that if someone robbed and later on he denies it and he took a false oath and then he come back and admitted it, so you need to pay in addition to the principal also 1/5. And he shall restore the robber to the robbed item that he robbed, and he shall add its 1/5 payments to it. So we learn in the Mishnah in Bava Kamma 103, Utnan natan lo et hakeren venishba lo al hachomesh. So the robber gave the robbery victim the principal, and he took a false oath to him concerning the additional 1/5 payment, asserting that he had already paid it. Then the additional 1/5 consider a new principal obligation. הרי זה מוסיף חומש על חומש. The robber adds an additional 1/5 payment apart from the additional 1/5 payment about which he had taken a false oath. He had taken a false oath concerning the second 1/5 payment. He is assessed an additional 1/5 payment for the oath until the principal achit ma'et ha-keren pachot mishave pruta, until the keren, the principal, reduced to less than the value of one pruta. So Rava continues, the same apply to truma. Agabe truma ktiv ish ki yochal kodesh bishgaga v'yasaf chamishitav alav. If a man eats that which is sacred unintentionally, then he shall add 1/5 payment to it. Utnan, learning Trumo, chapter 6, the first Mishnah, Ochel Trumah v'shugeg mishalem keren v'chomesh. One partake the Trumah unintentionally pay the principal an additional 1/5. Echad ha-ochel, ve'echad ha-shoteh, ve'echad ha-sach. Regardless if it's a one who partake the Trumah, one who drinks it, one who applies an oil to himself, or whatever it is, ritually pure truma or ritually impure truma. Echad ha-ochel truma Torah, v'echad ha-omer, v'echad truma t'me'a. So, sicha k'shtiya, that Rashi said. So, echad truma Torah, v'echad truma t'me'a, m'shalem chumsha v'chumsha d'chumsha. So, regardless if he partakes a pure or impure truma, so he needs to pay 1/5 payment, and if he partook that 1/5, he pays 1/5 of its 1/5. So you have the famous Mishnah Brura, and you see also in the writing of the וילנה גאון, they ask about fat, about חלב. So we knew that חלב מותר בהנאה, ואסור באכילה ושתייה. So they ask, what about soap, the סבונים, that made out of חלב? The same you can ask about toothpaste, about water for toothpaste and things like that. So it's a question of תערובת and טעם. Anyway. ואילו גבי מעשר, לא מכתב כתיב ולא מתנתנה ולא יבאי או באי לן. When it's come to the מעשר, the second tithe, it is neither written in Torah, nor taught in the Mishnah, not raise a question before the Amoraim. So it means it's not ed, because you didn't find any implication that you have חומש לחומש when it's come to second tithe. גבי הקדש כתיב, אם המקדיש יגאל בטוב יסף חמישית כסף ערכך. When it's come to consecrated property, the Torah said in Leviticus chapter 27, if he who consecrated will redeem his house, then he shall add one-fifth to the money of his valuation unto it. So we derive from here, it's written in the singular. And then with none, we're going to study the Mishnah on page 55b, הפודד הקדשו מוסיף חומש. One who redeems his own consecrated property, that he consecrated himself, he adds one-fifth to the sum of the redemption. חומשת נען, חומשת חומשת לא נען, מי? So here we see a one-fifth, but you don't have the one-fifth on one-fifth. So what's the הלכה? So we might expand on that. גבי תרומה כתיב, יסף. When it's come to תרומה, this is written in Vayikra chapter 22, the word he shall add. So he shall add with vav, ve-yasaf, which means two. Gabi kodesh nama aktiv, ve-yasaf, so therefore the same. Or dilma, you may say, gabi truma aktiv, ve-yasaf, ishakalt levav, de-yasaf, if you take the vav, you add the vav, and alaha one-fifth of the one-fifth is derived in this way, if you take the letter vav of the word ve-yasaf, ושדית לי על חמישיתיו, and he cast it to the end of the word חמישיתו, חמישיתיו, it's one-fifth payment, it's then become the plural חמישיתיו, אבל לחמישיתיו, instead of חמישיתו, חמישיתיו. So it's one-fifth payment, and it's written in the case of robbery, that indication that one pay one-fifth of the one-fifth. אף אגב דכי שקלת ללבב די עשה ושדית לי על חמישית. So even if you take the vav of Yasaf and cast it to the end of the word chamishit, so it is only chamishito in a singular, that's an indication of payment only in a single one-fifth. So what's the halacha? V'tipuklei, Rashi here challenging, he says, how you put the vav in between, because it's either the beginning or the end of the word. Other Rishonim, Ritva and others challenge that, but anyway, V'tepoklei, the Havle Hegdesheni, so you may derive here that the of consecrated property from the fact that it is tantamount to a second consecration, one redeemed consecrated property with another item. So the question is, it's consecrated, so not all the halachot of consecrated property apply to it. They said, אמר רבי שמעון בן לוי, הקדש ראשון מוסיף חומש, הקדש שני אין מוסיף חומש. The first redemption, he had one-fifth. The second not. אמר לרב פאפי לרבינה, הכי אמר רבא. So רב פאפי said to רבינה, this is what רבא meant to say, said, חומש כתחילת הקדש נמי. So here you have the legal status of the additional one-fifth is like that of initial consecration, not like that of a second consecration. Maya ve'ala, what's the conclusion in regards to this rabbi's predicament? Amar tavyumi mishmei de'abaye, Amar k'ra, the Torah said in Vayikra chapter 27, v'yasaf chamishit kesef erkecha. So that's applied to one who redeems a house that he consecrated. So they said, then he shall add one-fifth of the money of your valuation unto it. So here you have a juxtaposition. Makish chumsho lekesef erko. The Torah juxtaposes its payment of one-fifth to the money of its valuation, which means the consecrated home. Ma kesef erko mosif chomesh, av kesef chumsho mosif chomesh. The same, just as when consecrating and redeeming the money of its valuation, one adds one-fifth, the same way as redeeming the money of its one-fifth, one adds one-fifth as well. So the same in the Hekdesh. If he ma'al b'chomesh, al ha'chomesh shelo. So that's the additional. Ma'ram Shifel Rashash have a discussion about how you treat the situation that in the Hekdesh, if you have the third, additional third to the second, until it's reduced to the level of Shve Pruta. But I would like to conclude with what we discussed earlier, Shlomo Zalman Auerbach Zatzal. So the Rav Moshe Shternbuch Shlita, he have a discussion based on the Psakim of Shlomo Zalman. What do you do with Am Haaretz that he put aside Maaser and then he ate it? And then he discovered that he should not eat Maaser. What do? You take a Truma that he ate. What do you do nowadays? Miyameinu, he doesn't carry a value because Miyameinu nowadays, you have no idea to whom to give. We don't know who is the Kohen Musmach or who is not. So it's carry any value or not. You cannot eat it nowadays. So there is a teshuvah based on Rav Shlomo Zalman that Rav Moshe Shternbuch Shlita expand a lot on this question.